Welcome to a new edition of the Neon Jazz Interview Series with jazz trombonist Joe Fiedler. We caught up with him on April 8th, 2020, as the coronavirus quarantine heated up to talk about his latest 2020 CD, Big Sackbut, live in Graz. We talk music, this new surreal life, the end of live jazz, and so much more. Dig this interview.
It's surreal for everybody. This is just something that no one from any generation has seen or could, you know, hypothesize on what this would be like. So you're right up in the middle of New York, correct?
I'm just north of the city, yeah, about 45 minutes north, so close enough. I mean, New York, we're so far from it being done here. I mean, hopefully they're thinking we might be turning the corner this week, but I mean, if 700 people died in New York yesterday alone, like, if that's turning the corner, like, holy moly.
Without a doubt. But yeah, so I've been really trying to kind of reach out to musicians and talk, and I think it's good to kind of focus on something other than what's been going on. And so thanks for taking a minute out today. I really appreciate it.
It's my pleasure, man. Thank you.
New material, talk to me. That's one thing I want to do is kind of get, you know, all of the cats that are out there right now that have new material out to kind of talk a little bit about their project. And, you know, now that we're in quarantine and people can listen to music, not that they couldn't before, but it's going to be a little bit more, I think, supportive of what's going on with the fact that live music is not happening right now. So talk to me a little bit about your latest project and kind of, you know, where people can pick it up and kind of that kind of thing.
Well, it's a live record we did in Europe in Graz, Austria, at the end of a short tour, a little week tour we did in December. We recorded live. And it's my group Big Sackbut, which is three trombones and tuba, of all things, with no rhythm section. And it's kind of my I started the group now almost 10 years ago as a kind of tribute or an homage to the World Saxophone Quartet with trombones, because that's one of my favorite groups, and David Murray is definitely one of my top influences. And the Big Sackbut had been kind of dormant for a while, and really not for any creative reasons. It's more trying to find a tuba player who could do this. The pool in New York even is only maybe two or three guys, and they had been so busy and it had been a little frustrating. So it was, but anyway, I felt it was time to reconvene, and I'm really happy with how it turned out. It came together all new music really quickly, and everyone stepped up, and there's nothing like being on the road and bonding to really let the music simmer. And just being out there with away from distractions is really different from being in the studio. So I'm really happy.
Very cool. Yeah, you know, I guess that's the thing. You know, it just so happens to be a live album, but I think that's going to be kind of the big thing as life gets back to normal. You know, what's going to be the architecture of, you know, the clubs that come back, the people that come back, and all of that. So I got a two-part question that's specifically tailored to this COVID-19 world we're in. First of all, do you see, because of what's happened, there being maybe positive changes with digital downloads and digital transmission of some things with artists? What's your take on that?
That's a tough question. I mean, I think the only positive side I could see is if the musicians start selling things off their own website without these platforms like Spotify or whatever, because I don't think those are going away, and they're still going to take advantage of the musician across the board. I think they're selling, like, I mean, it's like farm to table music is the only way I could see it going. And I hopefully maybe there'll be a turn in the public's awareness of that whole situation, and knowing that musicians can't, I mean, we have to get that message out, making our money from touring and from live performances. I'm not sure that's ever going to come back in the same way as we've known it before. And selling music online is going to have to be this kind of farm-to-table approach if it's going to work at all.
So on the other side of that, you know, now that we're kind of in this, you know, quarantine situation where the music is silenced, which is very bizarre, what are you hoping as far as revelations for both musician and audience member after we get back and we can actually see music live? What are you hoping that people realize and how they approach, you know, both the bandstand and being in the audience?
Two parts. For the audience side, I'm hopeful, and I've been talking with a lot of musicians about this, that the whole idea of, instead of going to a gig, I'm going to Google that guy and watch YouTube clips of him because it's free and I'm in my little room. I think the need to get back out and the need to be social hopefully can manifest itself in going to performances again, which used to be a thing. And that's my big hope, that's a big catalyst to get people back in the club and come see live music because they've been holed up for however long it's going to be. As far as musicians, I think the overriding joy of being back in front of an audience and playing their horns in public is just going to be off the hook. I think there's going to be a greater sense of connection to the audience and a greater sense of freedom, I would think, that's going to let the music, you know, should launch it forward, I hope, in new directions.
Any other thoughts on kind of where you, like, you know, how people can access music, how they can kind of support the musicians right now?
I think, I mean, just buying, not just even buying their music directly from them if you can, which again, that's tricky these days. Most guys don't sell it through their own website. But Bandcamp is the best musician friend, I think, of all the platforms out there. So go, please buy stuff on Bandcamp. But the other thing is engaging in social media and liking their YouTube page and drawing attention and sharing links and sharing Facebook posts and Twitter posts and Instagram. And just continue to raise awareness in these times when we don't have the performance opportunities. So then when we do come back, we have 1,000 more followers and we have an easier way to get to people and get to presenters. I think that's the only way we can go right now.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree. I've thought about the same thing. Joe, thank you for taking some time out to talk with me on Jazz today. It's a pretty extraordinary time for the human species. So thanks for taking a minute and talking about the music. I appreciate it.
The pleasure's all mine, anytime.
Thanks for listening and tuning in to another Neon Jazz interview, where we give you a bit of insight into the finest cats in New York, Kansas City, and spots all over the world, giving fans all that jazz. And thanks to Joe for his time, music, and stories. If you want to hear more interviews, go to Famous Interviews with Joe Domino on the iTunes Store. Visit neonjazz at youtube.com. And for everything Neon Jazz all the time, go to the neonjazz.blogspot.com. Until next time, enjoy the jazz, my friends.
Neon Jazz.